This is the most famous McLaren SLR of all time because this was owned by none other than superstar Paris Hilton. Cars are sometimes made famous by their stories, but this one might have one of the craziest of them all. When you get this much star power, what kind of cars do you choose? And this is the SLR McLaren Mercedes that came out quite a long time ago, but when it came out was one of the most expensive cars on the market. So with this story, with how crazy it was, how good of condition is this SLR, and what is it like to drive one of these? So this car used to belong to Paris Hilton, doesn't anymore. Now it belongs to Ed Bullion. Ed, you just find the craziest stories when it comes to car buying, and of course, supercar buying. The McLaren SLR was kind of a weird test run with McLaren in a lot of ways. They wanted to learn about production for the future, for the 12C and stuff like that. But it still seems kind of out of place as a McLaren.
It doesn't matter where I take it. Somebody says that, like, is that a prototype for some new Mercedes?
Like a concept car?
Yeah, because it looks like a caricature of an SL55. There were three things that the car got really, really kind of knocked for. One of them was the strange styling, which led to some of the weirdest visibility in any car ever.
Like, this is really
you can't
strange.
Feel out the corners of this car. Like, I mean, I've had it for now a couple of weeks, and I have never parked it and been where I thought I was. I'll get used to it, but the nose is so long, the rear three-quarter is just full of car, and so it's dimensionally strange.
Right.
And it very much has this, like, Batmobile feel.
You know what? It does feel Batmobile-ish, but what's not like the Batmobile is the brake feel.
Yes,
which
that was
I'm
thing
just
too.
Gonna be nice. It sucks.
Yeah.
It's not good. It's very squishy, non-confident, inspired. It feels like you're doing a track day and you're starting to lose your brake fade.
Right.
Or starting to lose your brake pad, excuse me. Like, but all the time. But that is because they thought people were going to be nailing the brakes so hard that the air brake would kick on.
That's it. So it has an air brake that deploys as a rear wing and then all the way up for an air brake. And that balances the brake feel out.
So tell me the story of, like, the famous picture.
Yes.
Of where this car was with Paris Hilton and, I guess you could say, the superstar trio.
At the time, probably the three most famous women on Earth.
Right.
And so, yes, it belonged to Paris Hilton, and she drove it a lot. She had a lot of great cars. She had a few Ferraris, she had a few Bentleys, she had an LFA, and so she loved them, and she drove it all the time. I mean, it has 21,000 miles.
Yeah.
Most of them were accumulated in the first, you know, few years of this car's life when she was driving it all the time, and I think that's really what McLaren thought when they built it, was that very wealthy people are gonna buy a car that they want to be fast and cool and have all the superlatives from a performance perspective, but they really want it to be usable. And
right.
So they wanted to build it with a partner that could make a great daily driver car. And at the time, in the mid-2000s, no one was doing that better
than Mercedes.
Nobody. This was, 03 was the first model year in the US for the 55 compressor cars, like the CL that I set the Cannonball record in. So I love the basis of this engine because I've had it in several cars over the years. Paris owns the car and is driving it around, and she and Britney Spears, being good friends, were gonna go out to some clubs one night. And early in the evening, as Britney Spears is, I don't know if she was getting in or getting out,
sure.
But because of the carbon tub design in this car, the door sill is extremely high. And the seats are very snug, they're one-piece carbon buckets, and so when you get out, it's almost impossible to do so with your knees together.
Right.
And if you happen to not be wearing underpants, you are going to expose yourself to whomever is right
Hello
there.
Hello world.
In
yeah.
her case, hundreds of paparazzi photographers
which,
with very bright flashes.
Which is very unfortunate, and especially, I know, this is not a plug or anything. If you haven't gotten to watch that documentary, The Frame, I highly recommend it.
That's
because it.
It
relates to our story right now, because it'll have way more meaning if you understand the context of the mental state that Britney Spears was in, right? And
exactly.
And how tragic it was.
And yeah, this was kind of right at the start of her mental and emotional decline, unfortunately.
Right.
And so it led to her shaving her head and bashing in paparazzi windows with golf clubs and umbrellas. And, you know, it's a very, very unfortunate thing. I think she's in a good place now, is what that documentary made
yeah.
it seem like. But yeah, that was a tough time for her as probably the most famous person on Earth. Then later in that evening, they pick up Lindsay Lohan at another club. And so they're both sitting in this seat.
Which is a very small seat, by the way.
It is.
So for two people to fit is pretty remarkable.
Exactly. And so they cruise around, and it is probably the most 2000s photo that exists.
Yeah.
And I'm not a fan of popular culture.
Sure.
I don't even know what popular culture is most of the time. But,
everybody knew them.
A shot heard around the world.
Yeah.
And I don't care how famous Lewis Hamilton or Gordon Murray or
right.
El Chapo's drug runners could possibly make a car. That pales in comparison to Paris Hilton at the time, or particularly the unsheathed undercarriage of one Britney Spears.
Right.
And
right.
So it's just, I think it's easy to say this is the most famous McLaren on earth, not because of anything McLaren did, but because of how many people have seen it.
Exactly. Who knows how many magazine photos, how many tabloids, how many any of that, because that was the era of just being in their face all the time, like just not catching a break,
exactly.
Right? Everybody, even if you didn't listen to Britney's music, even if you didn't watch The Parent Trap, you know, even any of that, people knew who those three people were, and it just shows the how powerful star power is when you can't avoid it. So there's the story.
Yeah.
So why do so many journalists and automotive people really dislike this thing? Is it because of the price per performance or how sketchy it can feel sometimes?
I mean, that's a very, very good point. So, you know, the car is fast. It goes over 200 miles an hour, obviously. It goes 0 to 60 in mid threes. But the brakes were so weird, and the handling feel was so... We'll go right on the highway up here. And the handling feel was so strange that it's a hard car to figure out from a performance perspective.
I've driven everything under the sun, and the brakes are still weird to me out.
Yeah, and this is the best braking SLR I've ever driven.
Oh, that's not good. The door handle to open the door is next to your leg. Dude, this thing. I'm impressed with the power.
Oh yeah, the power's fantastic.
I'm very impressed with the power.
617 horsepower.
How's the window go down? Oh, right here,
yep.
Next to my thigh, because that's the right place to put it. Is this a single clutch as well?
No, it's a slush box torque converter automatic.
Oh, okay, that's unique too.
However, it is bulletproof.
Okay.
And when you start thinking about aging supercars, the liability of transmission maintenance and clutch consumption and
sure.
actuator failure and all the things
like a non-LP Gallardo.
Terrifying.
Yeah.
And so in a lot of ways, I love that it has a regular automatic transmission. It means that like paddle shifting isn't the most pleasurable sensation,
right.
Because it's like telling an automatic, it's a Tiptronic is what it would be.
Kind of like what you'd find in a normal commuter car when you're just going up and down.
Exactly.
Okay.
This thing, like if you were out looking for the ultimate performance car of 2006, this isn't it. And
no.
That's okay.
No, yeah. Okay.
It has that muscle car feel to it.
Oh my, I'm in... I see how some people think it's kind of floaty and a little sketchy, but I like sketchiness. I don't know. I'm weird.
And then you can make it hardcore manual. You got multiple adjustments.
No, it makes a good sound.
It really does. I mean, that is a great motor. Like, one of the best motors that anybody's ever made. And so that's where McLaren got to kind of dip their toes into being a manufacturer and assemble the cars, but they didn't have to design everything they didn't want to. They didn't have to figure out air conditioning and, you know, stuff like that. But
it was a Lego set.
It was.
It was great.
I'll take that. I'll make that better. I'll make that prettier, maybe, and I'll, you know, build a real car.
I actually dig the interior. I mean, the center console is pretty mid-2000.
Very much so.
But the rest of the car seems as though, at first glance, that it's held up pretty good. Like, the leather materials.
$463,000 new. In the same way that we saw this hypercar holy trinity with the 918 P1 and LaFerrari, it was alongside the Carrera GT and Enzo.
To see why people were like, why wouldn't you buy this instead? I'm starting to get it.
And, you know, this and the Carrera GT did not sell well at all new. Obviously, the Enzo's all sold out, but these cars, they did not sell well. They were not immediately well adopted by anybody other than celebrities. And it was kind of a big flex, but at the same time, it was very much a car that you could just get in and drive. And once you figure out the brakes, you know how to make a car stop.
Celebrities, when they're just like, oh, it's a really nice Mercedes, whatever, right? I get that. But when you have like a let's say, a hardcore performance person, yeah, they'd probably go get the CGT.
For sure, which everybody was dying in long before Paul Walker, and had the weirdest transmission to engage with on a road car.
Especially the first gear.
Exactly, yeah, because you weren't supposed to use the throttle in order to move around.
Dude, this thing sounds awesome.
And there is nothing like it. There's no other car built this way.
I'm trying to think of what to compare this to, and there's not really anything.
I mean, when it sold new, the primary two competitors were the 599 and the LP640.
Okay.
And, you know, both are entirely different executions of this idea of,
100%.
Like, a highway bombing supercar.
I don't know how to feel about this thing. Because on the one hand, I go, I don't like the braking. But it will stop. I'm just not used to it.
Yep.
But on the other hand, if I was up in the mountains, I don't know how I would feel. You know what I mean?
That's, I took one for about 1,000 miles of Gold Rush, including a lot of mountain roads. And it's got it, but it doesn't tell you that it does.
Okay.
And so
I can see that, especially with how long the nose is.
Yeah, I didn't upset the car, but you go into a turn like, I don't know if it's going to stick.
I don't
have a clue. Probably won't, but... Good news is every leading edge is carbon fiber.
Okay.
At first, you really can't tell if you like it. I sold a few of them while I worked at Lamborghini Atlanta, and I was always like, I don't know if I want one or not. But I tried to buy one years ago that was in a flood, but it ended up, they sold it out from under me to a guy in Saudi Arabia.
Is it this one?
And I think it's just cool. Like, it's an automotive experience that you can't find anywhere else. It's super value stable with the ability for it to go up in the future.
And especially the story that this one has.
Yes.
Which this probably has the coolest story out of any SLR McLaren that's in existence.
For sure. And, you know, Jay Leno loves his. Jeremy Clarkson loved it in racing against public transit to Norway. We've seen a lot of them do some really, really cool things. I mean, Richard Hammond called the 722 version, which was just slightly tuned, hypercar royalty, which hypercar wasn't really a word that got thrown around when this car was new. But, you know, it is... I love Mercedes products of this era, obviously, and this is the greatest Mercedes product that they could put together at that time.
Yeah.
And so, you know, to me, it's easy to love.
I'm a huge history nut, and I wouldn't say... that the history and story we said would be, you know, in a history book. But it's still cool to know the story behind the car, what the car's like to drive, and what it sounds like, because, wow. Now that I'm thinking about this, like, this is famous blonde chick driving this monster of a car. It's like, wow, she didn't crash it. Good for her.
That's right, we checked the paintwork.
On that note, guys, what do you think about this, and what do you think about the SLR McLaren in general? Do you think it's a weird move from McLaren, or did you think it was a good stepping stone for what they did later? Because now they got it going on. Ed, once again, thank you so much. Appreciate your time. Make sure to go follow the YouTube channel VinWiki, and I upload on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Sundays. And I will see you guys next time. Take it easy. Have a wonderful day. Goodbye. If you guys like these videos and want to support my channel, make sure to head over to PattersonCarCare.com. It is my original formula detail brand that makes life so easy washing your car. Everything from cleaning your wheels in just around a minute, or any other product that is just as easy to use. Thanks so much for watching this video, and I will see you guys next time.